This morning. Father, to be able to come before the throne of grace, to lay down everything that we are, everything that burdens us, we can give to you. I ask, Father, that you would move today as you desire in this service, that you would touch those that need a touch, that you would encourage those that are downfallen. I ask, Father, that you would heal those that are sick. I ask, Father, that you would teach us to worship you in spirit and in truth. Receive our praise this morning, Father, because you are worthy. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Cross out, you see an empty tomb.
Thank you. Oh, Strangely dim in the Teach me your ways, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Give me an undivided heart, that I might fear your name. Teach me your ways, O Lord, grant me a humble heart. Young ones where they're at. God, you know each and every one of them.
who have brought them forth, you have given them life. And I pray that your Holy Spirit would move in among them, reaching deep into their hearts. Even at a young age, Lord, convicting them of sin, helping them to realize that they need a Savior, Jesus Christ, the righteous, and that they would not resist that, that they would not turn away from that, but God, each of them would come to that point where you offered them salvation and they would receive it, and that they would grow in you, that they would become a generation who loves you, who wants to serve you. We bless them, God. We ask your favor upon the teachers, God, that they would speak the right words in the right way, that you would direct them. These young minds be able to just grasp what your word, your whole word, the whole counsel of God, what it is, it's for them. We praise you in the name of your precious Lord and Savior, Jesus. Amen.
If you would open up your Bibles to 2 Kings chapter 5. We're going to get there in a minute. There's some things that I want to discuss before we get to that point, though. I don't know how many of you have been keeping up with what's been going on in Kentucky. Anybody here? Anybody know what's going on at Asbury College?
The revival.
All right, that's really an interesting thing to say. What does revival mean? What is it?
Rebirth.
Rebirth? Okay.
Dedication.
What's that?
Rededication.
Okay. You know, it's interesting when people talk about revival, because if you've ever studied revivals throughout the course of history, we can actually go back in the Christian church to the founding of the Christian church, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in Acts chapter 2. And then throughout history, there have been a number of revivals here in the United States. We've had several big movements that came out of revival, the Azusa Street revival, the New England revival. There have been several periods of revival. But what I find very interesting about these revivals is no two of them worked in the same way. The revival in the Hebrides and the revival in New England were both very similar in that it was a call to people to come to holiness and righteousness, to give up the debauched lives that they were living, and they had similarities in that regard. The Azusa Street revival did not have that. That had more to do with outpouring of gifts. But I've been watching this with some, I don't want to say concern, because I'm not concerned about what God's going to do. What I get concerned about is when people start trying to tell God what he's supposed to do or how it's supposed to work. So starting in the first week of this month, Asbury College, it's a Christian college in Kentucky, they were having a chapel service, and this chapel service has not yet ended. They have had the chapel on the school is packed. It's been going 24/7 for coming up onto 3 weeks now. People from other states are making their way to Kentucky. But what I've been watching is how the Christian world is responding to what's going on at the Asbury College. And I seem to find things falling in two general directions. And then there's a third area that actually is the one I want to talk about more than the other two. On the one hand, you have a lot of people in the religious community that look at Asbury and they look at it as, okay, whatever, there's people are just having a moment. This is all part of the evangelicalism, Pentecostalism, the charismatic movement, whatever. It comes, it goes, and life goes on. Even some so far as saying that because it doesn't have great speakers and it's not drawing great worship teams and it's not a move like that, this obviously can't be a move of God. It appalls me that so many in the Christian church refuse to acknowledge what God is doing. Now, is everything that's going on there of God? I believe that God in his faithfulness takes care of his own. But ultimately, when it comes down to the very root of things, God is sovereign. Okay. God is not obligated to move in a way that we desire or what we expect. Actually, most times in my life, God doesn't move the ways that I expect. If God chooses to move at a small Christian college in Kentucky, then I want to say praise God. Okay? I want to give God glory. I have seen testimonies of people that have been there that, there's no outpouring of speaking in tongues. There haven't been tremendous ministries of miracles and healings and things of that type in what's going on there. But what people are doing is they are coming into the atmosphere of this place and they are finding peace with God. And ultimately, that is what all of this is about. That we would be reconciled, that we might have peace with God. Now, on the other end of this spectrum are those that get very excited about the things of God. And you guys know me, I'm not an excitable person. I don't tend to get real up about much of anything. Family, grandkids, come see me after church. I'll show you more pictures of my newest grandbaby. But I was something of a misfit growing up in a Pentecostal and charismatic church because I don't have a lot of outward emotion. But what concerns me on this end of the spectrum is the people that are wanting to control how this should go. They want to take whatever it is that God is doing and add to it. So on the one hand, you have the naysayers that want to take away what God might be doing and excuse it and write it off and just kind of cast it away. On the other hand, you have people that are all for it, but they want to be in control. They want to direct how it's supposed to go. They want to be involved in what God's doing, but all too often their involvement in what God's doing is to take control and tell God how it should be done. Let me just remind you, God knows better than we do. Okay? Nothing shakes him on his throne. Nothing surprises him. All right? If you've had an idea, I guarantee you, God's had it before you. Okay? So both of those things, I've seen comments from both ends of the spectrum, and some mild and some going to pretty radical. But there's a third group that actually kind of concerns me a little bit more. And those are the Christians that are completely apathetic. They just don't feel much of anything. They don't think much of anything. They're almost agnostic in their view of what God may be doing or may not be doing. They just don't care. And that is a very dangerous place for a Christian to be. Okay? And don't get me wrong, there are times where we have more excitement and there are times when we have less excitement in what we're doing in the kingdom and our relationship with God. There are moments when things seem to be pouring blessing into our lives and everything just seems to be working out fine and we sing God praises, sing his praises and worship him and we give thanks to him. There are other times where things just aren't going really well and we scratch our heads and we ask God, where are you? He's still there, okay? But what concerns me is how many people in the church just really don't care. They just don't care. We have prayed for a revival. I don't know, Dave, how many years have we been praying for revival? Years and years and years. But one of the things I've been challenged in looking at Asbury is, what is my expectation of what a revival should look like? And so I just want to lay before you today, if God is moving, let's go back to the second chapter of Acts. Okay, Jesus has ascended into heaven. The cross is over. The tomb is empty. He's ascended into heaven. He has told the disciples to wait in Jerusalem until the Spirit comes. And they're in Jerusalem, which is the high point, the highest place in Judaism, and even should be in Christendom at that time. And so they're hanging out in Jerusalem. They're seeking God's will. The Spirit comes upon them, and they go out, and they're speaking in other tongues. But what's interesting about their speaking in tongues here is, I don't know if God blessed their mouths to speak a language they didn't know, or bless the listeners' ears to receive a language that was known to them. I don't know. God can do it any which way. I wasn't there, and I'm not a part of it, so I don't dare say which it was. But I know this. In the midst of Jerusalem, when the Spirit fell, there were godly men and women going around at that time, and they saw what God was doing. And there were many that embraced it, and they said, yes, we want to be a part of that. There were many that stood in opposition to that, and they raised themselves up in opposition. And we see this in the Judaizers, we see this in the religious leadership. But what we don't see a lot about in Scripture is, what were the rest of the people doing? What were they doing? This was one of the high feasts where the men had to come to Jerusalem to celebrate, right? And so it was full of believers in God, in the Hebrew Scriptures, and they're celebrating the 49, and so they're coming together and they're celebrating. What are they doing when they see God move? What's going on? See, this is the thing that concerns me the most about the church in America today. It's not, are we in God's will? Are we out of God's will? It's that we're so darn apathetic about God's will. We want salvation where we want it and how we want it. We want a relationship with God to be predicated on our expectations. We want the rewards in heaven, and we want to be blessed on earth, so long as it doesn't interfere with what we've got going on. Second Kings. Let's look at Second Kings. I want to share something that God laid on my heart. And this was before I knew anything about Asbury. We'll come back to that here in a little bit. So we're in 2 Kings chapter 5. Now we have this interesting story that is stuck right in the middle of what's going on in 2 Kings. So 2 Kings chapter 5, starting in verse 1. Naaman, commander of the army of the king of Syria, was a great man with his master and in high favor, because by him the Lord had given victory to Syria. He was a mighty man of valor, but he was a leper. All right, so I'm just going to kind of set the stage right now. Syria is an ascendancy. We know from the history of what was going on with Israel at the time that they were given, God had given them power and authority at a particular time in a particular place to accomplish God's will. All right, and so we have this Naaman, who is a commander of the Syrian armies. He is a man that God has blessed, and yet he has leprosy. And leprosy in the Bible, that's used for, it's a generic term for any number of skin diseases that are going on. But when we see leprosy, it's highly contagious. And people that have leprosy are usually outcast. They can't come into worship in the temple. They're people that are set apart because of its contagiousness, the contagion. And so Naaman has leprosy. Listen, you can be right dead center in the will of God and have terrible things happen to you. Do you understand that? You can have absolutely horrible things going on in your life, and you can be right where God wants you. See, we tend to associate God's blessing with God's favor. We tend to associate prosperity with God's favor. And yet, the vast majority of Christians in the world today suffer for their faith. What then do we say to them? Oh, you must not be in God's will because you're suffering. If only you had sufficient faith, you wouldn't suffer, you'd prosper. I'm sorry, but that's not love of God that follows that theology. That's love of money. And you can't love both. Okay? So Naaman, he's achieved this rank. It says he's a man of valor, and yet he has leprosy. Going on, verse 2. Now the Syrians, on one of their raids, had carried off a little girl from the land of Israel, and she worked in the service of Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "Would that my lord were with the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." So Naaman went in and told his lord, "Thus and so spoke the girl from the land of Israel." And the king of Syria said, "Go now, I will send a letter to the king of Israel." So he went, taking with him 10 talents of silver, 6,000 shekels of gold, and 10 changes of clothing. And he brought the letter to the king of Israel, which said, "When the letter reaches you, know that I have sent to you Naaman, my servant, that you may cure him of his leprosy." And when the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes and said, "Am I God to kill and to make alive, that this man sends word to me to cure a man of his leprosy? Only consider and see how he is seeking a quarrel with me." Now, how many of you, if a leader of a country, even a what might be an overtly hostile country, let's just say, President Kim of North Korea, he sends you a letter with a person, and he tells you, "I want you to heal this person of his affliction." How many of you would have the confidence to say, "Okay"? Because see, in this is an implied threat, and this is what the king is reading, the implied threat. If you don't heal my servant, things are not going to go well for you. All right? And so the king, he's like, "I don't know, what do we do? What do we do?" He's trying to start a war here. But when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent to the king saying, "Why have you torn your clothes? Let him come now to me, that he may know that there is a prophet in Israel." Oh man, we all need a prophet sometimes, don't we? Don't we? Where somebody comes to us and you can just tell them, "Hey, go talk to that guy. He's got the answers." Right? Right? So Elisha, basically, he tells the king, "What are you worried about? What are you worried about? You might be afraid of Syria, but Syria needs to be afraid of our God. Send this guy to me. So Naaman came with his horses and chariots and stood at the door of Elisha's house. And Elisha sent a messenger to him saying, "Go and wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored, and you shall be clean." Wow. Okay, so here comes a great military leader of Syria. He comes to the king. Elisha has said, hey, send him to me, we'll take care of business. And Naaman shows up. Elisha doesn't even come to the door. He sends a servant with a message. Hey, go do this, you'll be clean. Now, if you were Naaman, would you be offended? Honestly, I'd be offended. Really? They told me to come see this guy and he doesn't even want to see me. Okay, so let's look a little bit about Naaman's thought process here. Because he gets angry. But Naaman was angry, see, I told you, and went away saying, behold, I thought he would surely come out to me and stand and call upon the name of the Lord his God and wave his hand over the place and cure the leprosy. Because, you know, when you're going to do miracles, you got to have emotions or something. There's got to be some demonstration to get the healing going, like, you know, kickstart the healing. And so, honestly, I don't think any of us would be a whole lot different. Hey, man, this guy's going to heal you. Go talk to this guy. Woo-hoo! All right, we're going to... Oh, yeah, you know what? In order to get healed, you got to go dunk yourself 7 times. Now, listen to what he's saying here. He goes, are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean? So he turned and went away in a rage. But his servants came near and said to him, my father, it is a great word that the prophet has spoken to you. Will you not do it? Has he actually said to you, wash and be clean? So he went down and dipped himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the word of the man of God. Okay, I'm going to pause there for just a second. Because this is, Christians are a lot like Naaman. And this is what I see kind of going on in Asbury. Naaman came with an expectation, not only of what was going to happen, but he came with an expectation of how it was going to happen, didn't he? I mean, you see by how he responds, he had this certain idea of what was going to take place. Now, I don't know what miracle processes were in place at the time. I don't know what book they were reading to get the order right. But obviously, he had this expectation that Elisha was going to come out, and he was going to go through these motions, and he was going to do something and such to heal Naaman. And then he tells him, go dunk yourself in the Jordan. Now, the Jordan is not a great river compared to some of the rivers in the area. It's actually a fairly small river, flows from the Sea of Galilee all the way down to the Dead Sea. And in places, it's pretty muddy and murky. In other places, it actually runs pretty clean. But Naaman, he's struggling with an issue here, and it's not his leprosy, is it? What's the issue that Naaman is really struggling with here?
Pride.
Absolutely. Hey, look, I'm a great man. I'm held in honor in my country. Even your country has heard about me. Okay? And you tell me to go dunk myself in your puny, ridiculous river? We've got better rivers all over Syria. What is this? Now, this servant, I would love to know this servant. Because he had some moxie, didn't he? Because he knows Naaman's upset. Naaman is not in a good mood. I came all this way, and this is how they treated me. And so the servant goes to him and says, hey, look, what would it hurt? This is all he told you to do. Just go dunk yourself 7 times. Doesn't work. Doesn't work. You're no worse off than you were before. A little bit wet. Give it a try. Now, I don't know what the relationship was between Naaman and the servant, but obviously the servant had some pull with Naaman. First, because he was able to come to him and talk to him. Right? How many of you want to go and talk to your boss when you know he's mad? Okay? And so, first we know that he had some measure of respect for Naaman because Naaman listened to him. And then see what happened when his servant said, hey, if this is what he said, do, don't you want to be healed? I mean, give it a shot. And so Naaman goes and he dunks himself seven times. By the way, what does the number seven mean?
Completion.
Completion. Remember, there's always something going on with everything that's said in Scripture. Seven times. Do you think it was random that Elisha told him to dunk himself seven times? I don't think it was random at all. I think this is Glenn's thoughts, okay? This is not Scripture. This is what I think happened. I think the first time that he dunked himself, he came up, the only change was he was wet. And then over the course of the next six times, each time he went down, he came up. And I think the spot was getting a little less, and a little less, and a little less. And when he did it the seventh time, the number of completion, when he came out, he was without blemish. See what it says here. So he went down and dipped himself seven times in the Jordan according to the word of the man of God, and his flesh was restored like the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. Okay? So, what does this have to do with anything? Let me ask you this. Do you desire to be used of God? Do you desire to be in His will and to be used how He would desire to use you to bring glory and honor to His name?
Yes.
Do you really desire to have God move in your life, to begin bringing about changes? Things that you struggled with, things that may not even just sin things, but just things that have made your life hard. Do you desire to have God move in your life? What are some of the things, the expectations that we have for healthy Christian living? What are some components that make a healthy Christian? What things would be present so that you would know that this person is living a healthy Christian lifestyle?
Spend time with God.
Wow. Boy, you guys all went
once.
Spiritual fruit. Okay, how do we get spiritual fruit?
Spending time with God.
Spending time with God. What else?
Prayer.
Prayer. Okay.
Time in His Word.
Time in His Word. Scripture. Absolutely. What else? Fellowship with other believers, absolutely. Absolutely. There are certain components that God has put into place to help us walk in a manner that reflects Christ to people around us. And it's not something that we put on from the outside. It's something that is birthed from within us. He has called us to be His disciples, not to just be converts, but to be His disciples, to come under His authority, to come under His teaching, that we might grow into what He has called us to be. Okay? Each and every one of you has a calling that God has put on your life. And a lot of those callings are radically different from other people in this room. Okay? If you want to live a life that is pleasing to God, there are certain components that must be in place. Now, here's the danger that the church so often falls into. We cannot allow those disciplines to take the place of the relationship with God. We cannot worship those disciplines more than we worship God. Those disciplines must be in place so that we can come into that place where God can bless us and pour out. I'm not talking about stuff. I'm talking about growth. I'm talking about maturity. I'm talking about having victory over sin in this life, not just the life to come. So there are certain components that work together to make a healthy Christian lifestyle. Some of those components are things that we are expected to do on our own. Others of those things are that we are expected to do corporately. When God established the church, when God established Ecclesia, the church, He established it to function as an organism, a living, breathing body, ministering to each component by each component, over which is Jesus Christ, the head. Okay? And so there is a reflection of everything we do that works down, and there's a reflection of everything we do that works up. And by up and down, I mean this. I'm talking about the church universal. There are disciplines that the church universal has to put in place in order to accomplish God's will, to be a part of what God desires the church to be. And then there are the church local. So instead of the church worldwide, you start looking at smaller components of the church and the church local, like the Jesus Community Church. Those same traits that should be present in the church universal should be present in the church local, right? If it's going to be a healthy church, it needs to be a praying church. If it's going to be a healthy church, it needs to be a church that's in the Word. If it's going to be a healthy church, it's going to have fellowship. It's going to have worship. It's going to have discipline. Okay, these are all components that God has put into place to bring about healthy living in a spiritual relationship with God. Okay, and so we bring that down to the church local, and what applies to the whole applies to the local churches. But it also applies even more minutely than that. It applies to the church particular, the church individual, you and me. Those same traits that allow a church to be healthy universally and locally apply to us particularly. Those same disciplines have got to be in place. Why? I don't know. Because that's what he said. That's how he chose to do things. Sometimes they don't make sense. They don't have to make sense. God didn't say that he's impressed with people that make sense. God wants people of faith. Because without faith, it doesn't matter your theology, it doesn't matter your doctrine, it doesn't matter your apologetics. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. You can't do it. And so God has established these things and he's put them in place in order to grow a healthy body. Why prayer? Well, I can look at things that are absolute positive outcomes of this. I don't know about you guys. I honestly don't, because I remember a time when I was different. But man, when we pray together, I am rejuvenated. I am encouraged. I am blessed. When we come together in worship, I don't know how people can go through life without worship. I don't understand how they can do it. It doesn't make sense to me. Fellowship, having brothers and sisters that you can trust and lean on, and being somebody that they can trust and lean on. Fellowship. Getting into the Word. Digging deep. Finding these miraculous things that God has sown throughout His Word just to encourage and bless us. What does this have to do with Naaman? What was Naaman's issue? Why was he offended? He had pride. He thought he should have been treated better. Yeah, I think he went expecting, you know, golden censers with incense wafting out of them and holy mumbo jumbo. Maybe a spiritual ointment or something. And when he comes to the door and Elisha doesn't even come out to talk to him but sends out a servant, he's ticked. Why? Because it didn't go the way he thought it should. He got an answer, didn't he? What was wrong with the answer?
It wasn't the one he wanted.
It wasn't the one he wanted at all. And he gets mad. And I love the wisdom of his servant. Hey, you know, if this is what he said to do, what does it hurt to do it? Go in the water, come up clean. If you come up and you still got leprosy, yeah, we declare war on Israel. No biggie. Right? And so Naaman does what the prophets told him, what the prophet spoke, that God would, how God would heal him, and he does it, and he comes up clean. Now, it's got to be, man, what is going through Naaman's mind as he's going, okay, how many times is it? Is this four or five? What am I up to now? You know? And then he comes up and he's clean. He's clean. Well, how does he respond? Oh my gosh, keep reading in the chapter. I'll let you guys do that on your own. He goes back to Elisha's house. He goes back to give thanks, to honor Elisha. And Elisha wants nothing to do with this stuff. Right? I don't need your stuff. Go on about your business. Okay? Here's what I want to put to you today. Sometimes God does things in ways we don't expect because it's a part of His plan, not ours. There is a part of me that very much wants to go to Asbury and just sit in the presence in that room. I just think that God is doing something incredible there. Okay, I'm going to share this. I was not planning on sharing this. You guys know I dream a lot. I have really weird dreams. About 3 weeks ago, and I can tell you the date because I wrote it down, I had a dream, and I'm not saying that this is a godly dream. I just find this highly coincidental. Okay, so about 3 weeks ago, I had a dream, and I was on the campus of the school that I attended, the college that I attended. And there was a revival going on, and the auditorium was packed full, and men would go up to the front and they would speak the words of God, and people would be excited, and they're receiving the things of God, and there was in the dream I was very excited to see what God was doing. And as this dream progressed, I noticed that there were people that were coming in, and they would take an individual, and they would just come up and they would just take the person and they would walk out. Okay. And I noticed that there were like 8 or 10 people that were doing this, and they would go up to somebody and they just reach down and they pick them up. I don't know that they even said anything. They would just kind of lift them up and then they would walk out. And immediately I got a check in my spirit. This is not good. This is something that is not supposed to be happening. And I was called over to the side of the auditorium that I was standing on. Somebody had called me over to the other side. And there was a woman standing down below. And she told me, today is the day. This is the day that we're going to do it. So she said, you need to get people together and we're going. And then it became very clear to me what was happening is that the enemy was sowing people among the church to lead people out and take them away from what was going on in the church. And they were taking them out and they were going to sacrifice them to the devil, to Satan. And I was trying to get the people in the auditorium's attention and nobody would listen. Nobody would listen. Because they were caught up in the moment. They were caught up in the excitement of what was going on. And so there was a group of about 4 or 5 people, and we went outside to stop this thing. And I could see them. They were loading these people that they had escorted out. They were loading them on a bus, and they were going to take them away. Okay. Now, I don't know that this has any significant particular with what's going on with Asbury or not. I can tell you the date. I wrote it down. We can go back and look at it. But I just find it remarkably coincidental. We know that the enemy comes in and he sows wolves in sheep's clothing, right? We've seen some of that here in our community, in our church. I absolutely believe, even if this dream wasn't given to me for the specific purpose of Asbury, I'm praying against that. Because I know the enemy, he knows what's going on. And I know he sold wolves in sheep's clothing among those people. Just read some of the comments that people are writing about this. You'll see the devil's hand at work. Okay? And so, what does this have to do with us? If we want to see God working at Jesus Community Church, if we want to see God moving in Ravalli County, up and down the Bitterroot, we've got to become more than what we have been for the last 20 years. How do we get there? I don't know. Honestly, I don't know. You know, every February we do 21 days of prayer. Why? Because I desperately want to know what God desires of Jesus Community Church for this year. I desperately want to see him moving, not just in our church, in all the churches up and down the valley. I want to see him moving out on the mission field with the people that we know are active in missions. I want to see God moving. I want to see God's name being glorified. Okay? 21 days of prayer. We average five people. Five people showing up for prayer meetings. Okay? Five. Now, I know, oh man, I'm starting to step on toes. Maybe toes need to be stepped on. I don't think that if you come to prayer, you're not coming to prayer is going to prevent God from doing what God's doing, because I believe and I trust in his sovereignty. But I will tell you this, if you're not getting involved in what God is trying to do here at Jesus Community Church, you're not going to be a part of what's being done. Okay? I have seen God do some incredible things in response to, direct response to prayers here at Jesus Community Church. We have had people that have been healed after they've had hands laid on them. We have had people that have had miraculous turnaround in their situations and their circumstances when God's people have prayed for them. We see this over and over and over again. Is it because we're such great prayer warriors? No. It's because we serve such a great God. Great God. So what if 21 days of prayer is dipping into Jordan seven times? Giving up that extra sleep to come and see if God will move. Is 21 days of prayer going to solve all the problems in the world? Absolutely not. But maybe it might just solve some of your problems. Maybe it'll solve some of my problems. Okay? 21 days of prayer. Lifting up the communities, the Bible-believing churches around the valley, lifting up the pastors and the leaders of those churches, asking God to guide them, to bless them, to strengthen them, to grow them, praying over their congregations that they would be protected from the schemes of the enemy, from the deception of this world, even from danger within in their own flesh, asking God to move in the lives of our missionaries in other places, seeking his will for them, that he would protect them, that he would provide for them, that he would accomplish what he desires through them. Praying for Jesus Community Church, praying over the individual ministries that transpire, that take place here at Jesus Community Church, praying over the ministry heads, praying over the leaders, praying for each and every one of you as God leads us to pray. Are you going to fall out of favor if you don't come to prayer? No. I don't think so. I think God's love was going to be just as immeasurable then as it is now. We just can't measure it. But what if? What if? I want to see God be glorified all around. I want to be excited when other churches are seeing miracles. I want to be excited when I hear other churches are having people come in and being converted and being saved, being rescued out of the morass and delivered into the light. I want to have an excitement when a fellow pastor preaches a message that convicts people of sin and draws believers back to that place where they want to be in a right standing with God, giving up those things that would take them from his presence, those things that would hinder them in their walk. I want to be able to witness and participate in that. I want to see that here. I want to see victory in each one of your lives here. I want to see people delivered from sin. I want to see people healed from the things that have hurt, not just physical, but things emotionally, things in your past, harm that has been done to you. I want to see people being able to walk in forgiveness as they have received forgiveness. I want to see people being so blessed to be in the presence of God that their circumstances outside don't matter. I want to see us be living, breathing witnesses of him in everything that we do. I'm not there. There are days where I know I don't give a good witness. where I'm off, I'm bothered by something, somebody says or does something that just, for whatever reason, that day throws my switch, and those are the days that I am working to overcome, right? But I want to encourage you. What if we can see God move in this fellowship, in this township, in this county, in this country, in this world? Okay.
But God,
absolutely. My favorite two words in Scripture, but God. But God, everything was horrible, everything was terrible, but God. They deserve death. They deserve eternal separation and damnation, but God.